Did you know that your social media scrolling could be a result of your brain's dopamine-seeking reward loop? Yes, that's right. The constant need to check your phone, the compulsion to scroll through feeds, the desire to get just one more like, share, or comment, all these behaviors are fueled by dopamine, a neurotransmitter that plays a pivotal role in how we seek rewards. Let's break it down. In the simplest terms, the dopamine-seeking reward loop is a cycle that begins with the anticipation of a reward. In the context of social media, this could be the anticipation of getting a like, a share, or a positive comment on your latest post. This anticipation triggers the release of dopamine in your brain, which in turn enhances your focus and motivation, driving you to perform the action that led to the reward in the first place. This is why you find yourself repeatedly checking your phone, even if you just put it down a minute ago. Even when you're not consciously expecting a reward, your brain is subconsciously anticipating the potential dopamine hit that comes with each notification. But here's the kicker: it's not the actual reward that causes the dopamine surge, but the anticipation of it. This is why, even after hours of scrolling, you still feel the urge to keep going. Your brain is continuously seeking that next dopamine hit, perpetuating the cycle of anticipation and reward. So the next time you find yourself mindlessly scrolling, remember it's your brain seeking a dopamine hit. Ever wondered why heartbreak feels so intense? It might surprise you that love and obsession share neurochemical similarities. Think about the last time you were in love. Your heart pounded at the sight of that special someone and you could hardly focus on anything else, right? Well, that's because your brain was bathing in a cocktail of feel-good chemicals like dopamine and oxytocin. These chemicals are responsible for the euphoria and intense focus you feel when you're in love. Now let's talk about obsession. You might think of it as something entirely different from love, but chemically speaking, they are not so different. When we become obsessed with someone or something, our brain also releases a flood of dopamine and oxytocin. These chemicals create a strong drive to get more of what gives us pleasure, reinforcing the obsessive behavior. So why does this matter? Well, understanding the neurochemical similarities between love and obsession can help us better navigate our emotions. It's essential to recognize when our feelings of love may be tipping into the realm of unhealthy obsession. Remember, while love and obsession might share the same neurochemical footprint, they are fundamentally different in their nature. Love is about caring for someone else's well-being, while obsession is about satisfying our own needs. In essence, love can sometimes feel like an obsession because, chemically speaking, they aren't very different. Can you trust your memory completely? The answer might be more complicated than you think. Picture a moment from your childhood. Can you see it clearly? Or is it more like a foggy dream? Now consider this. That memory, as vivid as it may be, might not be entirely accurate. This is the power of false memories. We are all susceptible to them, and in sensitive situations, they can even lead to incorrect confessions. False memories are a fascinating phenomenon, where our minds fill in the gaps of our past with fabricated, distorted, or misinterpreted memories. They're often created by suggestion or imagination, and can significantly distort our recall. For instance, someone might be convinced they witnessed a crime because of suggestive questioning, even if they were never at the scene. This isn't a sign of a faulty brain, but rather, it's a testament to the mind's incredible ability to imagine, to create, and to adapt. However, it does mean we should approach our memories with a healthy dose of skepticism. It turns out, our memories aren't as reliable as we'd like to think. Are you a morning person or a night owl? Did you know your preference could be embedded in your genes? Yes, you heard that right. It's not just about habits or lifestyle choices. Your genes could be playing a significant role in determining whether you're more active and alert in the morning or later at night. Let's delve a little deeper into this. Our natural sleep-wake cycle, also known as our chronotype, is largely influenced by our genetic makeup. This chronotype determines whether we're naturally inclined to wake up at the crack of dawn and feel sleepy as the sun sets, or if we're more inclined to stay awake into the late hours of the night and wake up later in the day. Scientists have identified certain genetic variants that are associated with being an early bird or a night owl. These genes influence our internal biological clock, which regulates our sleep-wake cycle. So, if you've always found it hard to wake up early for that morning jog, or if you're unable to keep your eyes open past 9 in the evening, it might not be due to a lack of discipline. Rather, it could be your genes dictating your natural sleep-wake cycle. This doesn't mean that we can't adjust our sleeping patterns. With the right strategies, we can tweak our sleep schedules to better align with our daily routines. However, going against our natural chronotype can be challenging and may lead to feelings of fatigue or sleep deprivation. So, the next time someone criticizes your sleeping habits, just blame it on your genes. Loneliness is not just a state of mind, it has significant effects on our health. Have you ever thought about how feeling alone can impact your physical well-being? It's a fascinating, albeit sobering, fact of psychology. When we think of loneliness, we often associate it with the emotional pain of isolation, but the effects go beyond the emotional realm and creep into our physical health. Research has shown that prolonged periods of loneliness can lead to an increased risk of heart disease. Just as our hearts yearn for companionship, they also bear the brunt of our solitude, and it doesn't stop there. Loneliness also weakens our immune system, making us more susceptible to illnesses. When we're lonely, our bodies produce more stress hormones. Over time, this heightened stress level can impair our body's ability to fight off diseases. But here's the silver lining. Just as loneliness can harm our health, social connections can significantly improve it. Having a strong social network can lower stress levels, improve our mood, and even boost our immunity. It's more than just a feel-good factor. It's a lifeline that keeps us physically healthy and mentally resilient. So the next time you feel the urge to isolate yourself, remember the importance of those social connections. Reach out to a friend, join a club, volunteer in your community. These simple actions can do wonders, not only for your mental well-being, but also for your physical health. Remember, maintaining social connections is not just about feeling good, it's also about keeping healthy.